être un homme de désir.
To be a man who creates desire, that's what I would like to be. I use the conditional tense on purpose. The couturier is a race apart. It's an exceptional race. But couturiers take themselves seriously. In fact, we take ourselves seriously. I don't exclude myself from this crazy world we work in. It's not a sort of specific aspiration. It's the desire, the need to create.
Paris, number 2 Avenue Montaigne, the headquarters of Emmanuel Ungaro. Not the most well-known or best-selling couturier, but certainly the most unusual. Everything this highly talented designer says or does separates him from the rest of the fashion world. The rooms are stuffed to the corners with materials, items of clothing, buttons and hats, souvenirs of more than 25 years in the fashion business. Silent witnesses to a long and enduring career at the top. Ungaro is a classic. He's been in the business since 1958, a business he learned from Balenciaga, one of the great post-war couturiers, who designed clothes on the model, not on paper. Ungaro has carried on this tradition. Whereas most of the others sketch out their ideas, or have them sketched, he works from life. Every dress, every suit, is created on a flesh and blood human being. Only when the design really works in reality does it appear on paper.
J'ai commencé à dessiner longtemps.
I started to draw years ago and found that the drawing imprisoned the real feeling. There's something very rigid about it, which doesn't allow thought to develop. But I suppose the main reason is that I learned to work like this from Monsieur Balenciaga. He used to say that you must work like a sculptor. And this rapport that you get between the girl herself, the material, the idea, the impulse, the need, the desire, is translated by movements, not just by a pencil. Our profession is not an art, it's a craft, a very beautiful craft. I think it stops you taking yourself too seriously, and it's also very ephemeral. We aren't made to be put in museums. We're not meant to be there for eternity. This business is made up of ambiguities, and I covet my ambiguity and cultivate it. Because my work is made up of this extremely rigorous, almost military discipline, and this craziness, this baroqueness, this strange desire.
Et puis cette folie, ce baroquisme, cette envie.
Ungaro is not of French extraction. His parents were Italians who fled Mussolini's fascist regime before World War II. The family settled in Aix-en-Provence. So Ungaro is the son of political refugees, a first-generation immigrant who's made it. His southern origins are evident in the style of his Paris apartment.
It's an overcast sky, a dreamy sky, simply because I think the light should come from there. It's because I like dim, rather secretive rooms which are shrouded in a sort of mystery.
J'aime les atmosphères qui sont, comment dire, baignées dans une espèce de mystère.
My apartment is full of very discreet lighting. Mainly so I can prolong the obsessions that I have in my work. I feel that I'm continuing the thoughts which pursue me at work in my home environment. That material was featured in my collection 5 years ago. And I thought it went really well with the heavy Baroque atmosphere in this apartment.
l'atmosphère onirique de cette pièce. Et c'est pourquoi je vous dis, on ne peut
and
pas
that's why I say that you can't really separate your private from your professional life. There's no sense of rupture.
Je ne le veux,
I certainly wouldn't want that.
Surtout pas.
Ungaro spends most of his time in this office. It's his meditation chamber, the source of his inspiration.
Basically, there is no one specific source of inspiration. There is desire, there is a wanting. And I think that's what leads a creator to express what is interesting in him. In any case, the word creation is a bit suspect because it's made up of your memory, your own culture, childhood, adolescence, things that you've experienced first, how you have spent your life, what desires have been buried in childhood, so that you get to the stage you are at. You can see what stage you're at, but what have you gone through to get there?
Ungaro is touchy about it, but he began at the very bottom of the ladder, as an immigrant and a social underdog. But an underdog with a major goal.
When I started at the Balenciaga, they told me, okay, you can come here, but you're going to be an assistant in the sewing room, stitching linings. I said, look, I'll sew linings and even wash the floors if you want me to. My desire to work for him was so great. There's an English expression that I use. Success is the best revenge. But it's not a revenge on life, it's a revenge on the difficult progression an immigrant's child has to make. And I'm very grateful to this country for offering us shelter. France is a very welcoming country, but despite that, I suffered as a child from being an immigrant's son. Don't forget that at that time and during the war, we were treated like the Arabs are today. So the wounds I received as a child were deep and took a long time to heal.
Ungaro started the fashion house with his own money, and he's still the boss. The company has no debts and now belongs to the top five in the French fashion world. His collections also sell extremely well in Japan, Latin America, and especially the United States. The Ungaro family has had no money problems for years now, thanks to the fortune Emmanuel has made from fashion. But riches are relative, it would seem. He doesn't think that he leads a particularly luxurious lifestyle. On the contrary, a couturier has a life full of obligations.
The first constraint is having to present 8 collections a year. Don't you think that's enough? Would you like to sit 8 exams a year? Would you let yourself be placed in danger 8 times a year? Well, that's the first constraint. The second one is working obsessively 12 hours a day, practically all year round. Not to be able to get up tomorrow and say, I'm going to Honolulu. Not that I've got any reason to go to Honolulu, but it's the most extravagant trip I can think of.
Ungaro's collections are often a clear illustration of the fact that an artist's inspiration is the sum of impressions, experiences, conscious and unconscious feelings, all of which add up over the years. His clothes convey his feeling for Italian Baroque and French chic as a clear reflection of his youth in Aix-en-Provence, the wild years when he was in love with the gypsy girls.
C'est la richesse du sentiment, au fond.
It's really a search for past feelings, a desire to return to the days of my youth. When I was growing up in Aix, there was a big gypsy community. Oh, it was wonderful, and the memories are still very much alive in me. I can still see those young girls wearing big colored printed skirts with their father's striped jackets on the top. Those memories have remained intact and have evolved in me without my realizing it, causing me to want to open up new horizons with those print mixtures about which there was such a fuss to begin with.
Où se sont installés ces mélanges d'imprimés qui ont fait hurler beaucoup de monde au départ.
As with many great artists, the young Ungaro had to endure a period of opposition, indifference and heavy criticism. All signs of the fact that he was an innovator. A sign, too, that the press can often drive a person into the ground with a total lack of compassion, only to come crawling back when the person survives their attacks.
I've always said, and I say again, that it is extremely difficult to judge a couture collection, because you cannot claim the right to know what was going on in a creator's head when he suddenly had the impulse to invent a new language, and then to kill it at birth. Well, that is totally inadmissible. In fact, it's insulting too. It's what I've often gone through. Let's take the simplest example. In 1970, when I mixed up all those prints, I was shot down in flames. If I'd listened to those lady journalists then, what would I have done? I'd have stopped and gone on to do something else. But I didn't. Monsieur Balenciaga always said that you had to be stubborn to do this job. Yeah, and he was right.
Et Monsieur Balenciaga disait, il faut être très têtu pour faire ce métier. Et comme il avait raison.
In the elite world of Paris fashion, Emmanuel Ungaro is out of step. He attracts attention by doing so little which is conspicuous and remaining entirely normal. There's little to be seen here of all the fuss and temperament. The man is certainly a perfectionist and demands the utmost of himself and his colleagues. He is, after all, not in the prime of youth and finds it unnecessary always to be in the eye of the press and of the public. Ungaro is no great fan of the fashion milieu. The fashion kings, he thinks, all take themselves too seriously, and between them reigns only jealousy and lack of communication.
Les créateurs ne s'estiment pas.
Fashion designers don't appreciate each other's work, but simply keep an eye on one another, which is very damaging. When I showed my first collection in 1965 in a room of 30 square meters, I invited two great couturiers. Neither of them came. I'd happily open up my house. We should get to know each other.
Nous sommes là pour nous connaître.
Voilà, voilà. Non, non, non.
On ne peut pas.
Non, 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 non. Ça suffit, ça suffit.
Et maintenant, écoutez le scandale.
Nous sommes une race épouvantable.
Really, we're a ridiculous race. I have photographer friends who see each other all the time, painter friends who work together, musician friends who work together. The couturier is a race apart. I don't know, I think it's a perversion, a sort of megalomania.
Ongaro's clothes are not aimed at the young market. People aged between 35 and 55 suit them better. An excellent market segment too, because they're much wealthier than the youngsters. As well as clothes, there are the obligatory perfumes, which push up the turnover of all the main fashion houses. Ongaro has licensed the marketing of all his perfumes to the Chanel Group. Both companies share in the profits, which are substantial, although not desperately important for Ongaro, according to the company's financial director.
Our turnover is 1,500 million francs, of which 85% is couture. That is to say, clothes and accessories, and 15% is perfume. I would say that we are the opposite of the other companies in the luxury fashion industry, most of whom have 80% of their turnover linked to perfumes and the rest to clothes.
Ongaro has not been spared by world recession. They're certainly selling less than the boutiques, although the development of perfumes is limiting the damage.
Globally, the rise of perfumes has allowed us to combat a minor downturn in the rest of the business. And I would say that we have a certain stability in the lines, but a slight decrease in the top of the range. But some lines are moving faster than others. We are now seeing growth in the Bridge distribution lines. Last year in the States, Bridge sales grew from $12 to $20 million, a growth of more than 50%, which would be inconceivable for other lines which have found it difficult to hold on to their market.
The greatest difficulties are experienced here in the haute couture workshops, where the most expensive clothes are produced. No jobs have yet been lost, but the situation is critical. Haute couture is important for any fashion house in that it supplies the prestige and because new trends, colors, and models are experimented with here. The costs are very high, but Ongaro has it even harder here than other major houses with a bigger turnover.
For us, haute couture is research. Coming from industry, I would compare it to research and development. It's a necessary investment to be able to make a whole series of products. So it's unavoidable, a cost that we will continue to bear, but unfortunately, we get much less back now on the sale of haute couture with today's clientele. There were 5,000 customers 5 years ago. Now, if there are 1,000, it's a lot.
Paris, south, to the area around Aix-en-Provence. Emmanuel Ungaro takes us along to the place where he spent his youth, days which are still very important to him. This is his real home, where he finds peace and inspiration. He's converted an old monastery into a wonderful residence, in total isolation, far from the everyday world.
For many years, I lived so modestly that I would call it exemplary, in that I lived actually in one room. I bought my first car just a few years ago. I don't have a chauffeur. I don't live in luxury. I remember I must have been 14 or 15 years old, going into the country around Aix and burying my face in the cypress branches. I lived with them, I took them in my arms and almost made love to them. This smell of pines and damp earth, it's a wonderful experience. I have such strong, powerful memories which have been with me all my life. Now, this is an old southern tradition. It smells so good. But I'm not an alchemist myself. I'm not a creator of perfumes. What I can be is a creator of atmospheres. This house is full of things which have been collected bit by bit, because they have all been collected long before I had this house. This ceiling was found by one of my friends and me at a flea market in Milan. Yes, you can see depicted battles which are supposed to come from the end of the 16th century. And here these painted columns. This house, in fact, was converted by local craftsmen, masons, stone workers. Oh, they were all fantastic people, to whom I'm very, very grateful. They worked on this house as if it were their own, and it was very companionable. There was an unbelievable atmosphere, and everyone worked with their heart as well as with their skill.
Now,
with their heart.
Non seulement avec leur compétence, mais avec leur cœur. La mode n'est pas un phénomène isolé.
Fashion is not an isolated phenomenon. It derives from everything. It's an extrapolation of everything which surrounds us, social, political, and cultural phenomena. Where is the end in all that? Where is the beginning? Well, I reply that there is no end or beginning because we simply don't know. And it's just as well that we don't, because if we did, anyone could do it, and the work would lose both its creativity and its curiosity value, and that would be a real shame.
I was born in the south of Italy, which was a Greek colony in ancient times. So I'm a child of classicism, of the ancient Greek Empire. Where I was born, everything is rooted deep in classicism. I don't mean to say that I'm profound. I think I'm rather superficial. But as Nietzsche said, this superficiality is born of a profound sense of tradition.
Superficialità di cui mi beo nasce da una profonda conoscenza delle tradizioni.
Gianni Versace was born in Reggio Calabria, in the far south of Italy, on December the 2nd, 1946. He spent his childhood in the shadow of countless remnants of Greek and Roman antique beauty. Later, this ancient inheritance was to have a fundamental influence on his fashion designs. Antiquities are omnipresent in the current headquarters of the Versace Empire, situated in the old center of Milan. The mythological Medusa head has even become Versace's logo. This former monastery is not just a workplace, however. Versace has his private apartments here, a real Aladdin's cave, stuffed with art treasures, thousands of books, empire furniture, globes, and authentic Greek pictures.
It comes from my childhood, from the fact that I was born in a town by the sea with Greek ruins and Roman remains. Hence my love of classicism. Every one of us is a product of the life he leads, and classicism, sculpture and architecture have always surrounded me in my life. I need these things as I need to see the sea, the sky, the water. Classicism for me is fundamental.
The value of the treasures is inestimable. The Versace family has become rich thanks to fashion. The shows are the high point of the year for all the fashion houses. They last no longer than 3/4 of an hour, but are prepared in the minutest detail. During rehearsals, Versace leaves nothing to chance. The top models hired for the occasion have to rehearse for hours, closely following the master's instructions. Versace is always assisted by his younger sister, Donatella. They are an inseparable duo.
Okay, when Carl arrives, you turn all together, okay? You met on the middle, okay? Close here, you have to be close here. Chiuditi, Carla, per favore. You have to open when the way back, you have to show the line, okay? Avete capito? Fatela ancora.
Okay, we can start again, please.
The Versace company is a family business because as well as Gianni and Donatella, there is the older brother, Santo, who is the business and financial brain. Santo, Donatella, and Gianni Versace have worked together for most of their professional lives. The major figure in the family was their mother. She had a dressmaking business in Reggio. There, the young Gianni watched her making hundreds of gowns and found his calling.
My mother, she teach us first to be very tight together, all three of us, me, Gianni, and Santo. And she says, she always used to say to us, family, you know, it's the same blood, never gonna change that. So be close and try to be together all your life. And this, she told us and we did it.
My sister is amazing because she's very different. Because Gianni is as hard as granite. I'm more flexible, a bit more reasonable, more practical. Donatella is very soft, very feminine, very intelligent. She tries always to maintain the balance.
The textile factories where Versace clothes are made belong for the most part to the family, which is extraordinary in the Italian fashion business. To keep the factory busy,